Well, I'd like to thank the organization for the invitation, and to clarify one thing, my partner, Linda van Kamp, and I are both cardiologists working in the same practice, and we got lost since 10 years in the woods of CFSME, and until now we didn't find our way back to cardiology. And your second question will be, do we talk something else about CFSME patients during day, night, evening, Sunday, weekends, and as for, yes, sometimes we discuss Brexit. So, I'm going to talk about the orthostatic intolerance in our practice, and I manage. Yeah, well, that's it for today. Okay, this is the definition of the Institute of Medicine, and it's quite an amazing fact that it wasn't the orthostatic intolerance is a relatively new fact in the definition of by the several criteria. It was not mentioned in the CFS criteria. And in the ME criteria, it was one of the many in the lowest one, the criterion energy production and transportation impairments. But if you have, for example, cold hands and feet in wintertime, then you have 1 point in this energy transportation criterion, so you don't need to have orthostatic intolerance. Cold feet was just enough. So I think it's now in the new IOM criteria, it's one of the five most important ones, and I think it justifies the presence. So it's new, but we need to address a lot of studies to it. And what I'm going to do is talking about prevalence, the complaints, which is very interesting. Because it's quite different from the complaints, quite different. The prevalence of complaints is quite different from the prevalence of objective signs and symptoms during tilt table testing. Peter Rowe, he mentioned it before, is a highly variable prevalence between studies, between 30% and 69%. But the most important thing is that in all studies, the prevalence was higher than in healthy volunteers. If we look at our own data in more than 500 patients, then looking at symptoms and assessing whether or not there is a clinical suspicion of orthostatic intolerance, we see it in 80% of patients. So that's a very high prevalence. Nevertheless, in table testing in more than 300 patients, we see the hemodynamic abnormalities, the objective hemodynamic abnormalities. We call it early and delayed hypotension, which is another name in the syncope guidelines. Every year you got a new name, so we call it still the early and delayed hypertension POTS, and near-term copay is in 44%. So there is a major difference between the prevalence of complaints versus the objective signs and symptoms as you see during tilt table testing. And I'll skip to that. The prevalence is mentioned here. We measured in more than 200 patients. And the final thing is, how can we explain these differences in complaints versus objective signs? And this comes from a very interesting slide from the guidelines of the European Society of Cardiology. It's a very complex slide with all different abnormalities which may result in syncope, but the key factor is, and it's shown here in the middle, that a cerebral hyperperfusion is the key fact of syncope. So our idea was that the orthostatic intolerance complaints are all related to the hyperperfusion of the cerebrum by standing. So what we did since 4 or 5 years is that we measured during table testing the cerebral blood flow by measuring the internal carotid artery and the vertebral arteries in the neck. We measure that flow, combining the flow gives the cerebral flow, and we measure it while lying down and twice during standing up. And this is an example of a cerebral flow measurement of a patient on the left side. You see on top, on the left, there's the head, on the right is the body. The red color here is the carotid artery. This is while lying down. Here is the profile of the flow velocity through this artery here. And in the same patient here, while standing, you see here the artery, you can appreciate that flow is lower, and probably the diameter of the vessel is also lower. So in this patient, this is a typical example of a decrease of cerebral blood flow during standing, during the tilt table test. So we measured in quite a few patients the cerebral blood flow, and we also performed it in normals. Here on blue, while lying down, is the flow of the healthy volunteers. The blood flow is in patients slightly lower, but not significantly. But if you, while standing, there is a slight decrease in healthy volunteers of the cerebral blood flow, but there is a dramatic decrease in patients. And between mid-tilt and end-tilt, there is a slight further decrease. And we express it, the cerebral blood flow, as a percentage during standing of a percentage of lying. In healthy volunteers, if you look at mid and end tilt, there's approximately 4, 5, 6% difference decrease in cerebral blood flow. And as you can see here in the patients, immediately mid tilt, that means 15 minutes after tilting, there is a decrease of 15% in cerebral blood flow, which is further decreasing at the end tilt. But also, and that's very interesting, that even during prolonged sitting for half an hour produces the sort of similar results in patients. This is a study of older patients with a lower cerebral blood flow, and you see after sitting of half an hour that there is also a significant decrease in cerebral blood flow, and approximately 12% lower cerebral blood flow during sitting in these patients. And this undoubtedly, a lot of patients report also that during prolonged sitting they have cognitive dysfunction, pain, dizziness complaints. I think it's all explained by this decrease, even in sitting, of the cerebral blood flow. So in healthy volunteers, the cerebral blood flow decreases 6%, plus or minus 4%. And if you take a lower limit of normal of twice two standard deviations, then 71% of the ME-CF patients have an abnormal cerebral blood flow, even if they have a completely normal, that is to say a normal heart rate and blood pressure response during tilt table testing. So it's a very prominent feature of this disease. There are quite a few explanations. Chronic decrease of cerebral blood flow, of circulatory blood flow volume, abnormal venous pooling. But an important thing is that blood flow is also regulated by the brain itself, and maybe that the regulation itself is disturbed in these particular patients. So, in conclusion, orthostatic complaints and objective signs like pulse and orthostatic hypertension are very prominent in these patients. Orthostatic complaints are very diverse, but there is an abnormal decrease of cerebral blood flow at sitting and during standing in these patients, and even in the findings of an abnormal hemodynamic response, there is in the majority of patients an abnormal cerebral blood flow change. And there are in at least in Holland by physicians there are a lot of explanatory statements. The majority says it's all due to deconditioning, and a very good advice is buy a dog, go walking or swimming, it cures it all. And the most recent one, take a partner and have a baby. maybe this is due to increase in circulatory blood volume, a good explanation, but a good treatment, but okay. To further address this this issue, my partner will address the deconditioning issue.
Well, also thank you for the invitation to talk here, and I will enlighten maybe some comments from Peter about the deconditioning part. Are you putting up my...
No, if you press the down button.
The down button.
The pointer. So just press the down button. And we'll go back up.
Just go down.